Joining me now, as he does every week, is one of the finest thinkers of his generation, the author of international bestsellers including The Madness of Crowds and The War on the West, Douglas Murray. Douglas, the 24 presidential campaign is heating up. We know Donald Trump is a front runner to be the Republican nominee, but Ron DeSantis is ready for a fight.
Our border is a disaster. Crime infests our cities. The federal government makes it harder for families to make ends meet, and the president flounders. But decline is a choice. Success is attainable. And freedom is worth fighting for. Righting the ship requires restoring sanity to our society, normalcy to our communities, and integrity to our institutions.
Douglas, the Florida governor yesterday announced he's running on Twitter. It's a whole new ball game.
Yes, that's right, Rita. Everyone was expecting Ron DeSantis to announce at some point. There was rumor some weeks ago that maybe he was actually going to sit this one out, but most people thought at some point he was going to throw his hat in the ring. He is an extremely good candidate by any analysis. He spent years in Congress. He's been an incredibly successful governor of Florida. And at about half the age of the lead contenders for the Republican and Democrat Party, you know, he's got a certain spring in his step. His launch was unconventional, as you referred to, in that he launched in a discussion with Elon Musk and David Sachs on Twitter. Some of DeSantis's rivals enjoyed the fact that there was a certain amount of technical failure of a kind we all got used to during the pandemic years that went on at the beginning of the launch. But I don't think it made any impact at all. The hour or more that DeSantis was on air, he answered very in-depth questions. He didn't just give the jargon that any politician can give. He actually got into details and serious policy questions. And I thought it was a very good start, actually.
I thought he did brilliantly. And the fact that there were technical issues were largely due to the fact that so many people were trying to listen live. I think at one point there was more than 600,000 just listening live, and millions more have since listened to that 1 hour. So very impactful indeed. But of course, the media has completely lost its mind when it comes to DeSantis, as they did with Trump. Here's just one example of how unhinged segments of the mainstream media have become. This is from Vanity Fair. It says, Ron DeSantis will formally announce his 2024 bid with Elon Musk because apparently David Duke wasn't available. And this appeared, Douglas, under news, not some insane satirical far-left opinion section. This was supposedly a news story.
Isn't it amazing, Rita? I mean, we've talked about this before, about Elon Musk himself, of course. Elon Musk was found guilty by the New York Times of being born in South Africa when apartheid was going on. And they sort of tried to do a hit job against him as if the infant Elon Musk was in some way responsible for apartheid. I think everybody's alive to this now. Vanity Fair has been a very fine publication in the past. Clearly, they have no standards anymore. I mean, what is that? Anyone who doesn't know, David Duke is a former wizard, or whatever they call him, of the Ku Klux Klan. So it's just a straightforward attempt to say that Ron DeSantis and or Elon Musk is a member of the KKK. Well, here's the thing. They've been doing this against DeSantis and against Musk for years now. DeSantis has had his attempts to stop young children being exposed to overly sexualized material spun into being apparently a bill that stops you saying the word gay in Florida. You know, we went through that whole nonsense. Yeah. Just in recent days, the NAACP, one of the most famous historic organizations for Black Americans, issued a travel advisory that its members should not travel to Florida because Florida is unsafe because of DeSantis. Well, as he himself pointed out at his launch event, Rita, the chair of the NAACP actually lives in Florida, so he obviously doesn't abide by his own travel warnings. But this is all just a crock. They're just throwing everything they can at DeSantis, just like they did at Trump, just as they did actually at Mitt Romney and John McCain. I mean, all these people talk about the good Republicans. But they all smeared the so-called good Republicans as much as any of the ones that they think are bad Republicans. It doesn't matter. If you're on the right, you're fair game.
Absolutely. Doesn't matter how much you pander to the left, like a Mitt Romney, they will still say you're going to put people in chains and women in binders. Yeah. They're going to come after you personally. Now, let's go to the UK, where political leaders are having trouble with the simplest of facts. Here is Liberal Democrat leader Sir Edward Davey.
Listen, I've made it really clear that if people, the vast majority of people, will have the same gender as their biological sex, but a small number won't.
So a woman can have a penis?
Well, quite clearly.
There you go, Douglas. Quite clearly, women can have a penis. I mean, how can we trust these politicians to make critical decisions about the country when they beclown themselves with statements like that?
I know. I think you're very generous in calling Ed Davey a political leader, Rita, really. He's the head of the Liberal Democrat Party, which is the sort of fourth party in the UK Parliament these days. That's a party that's had an awful lot of ups and, well, rather more downs in its history. But yes, I find it fascinating watching these guys going through these contortions now. They remind me of you know, when we read about history and the wars of religion in Europe in the 15 and 1600s, you know, you hear of people who sort of went to the stake and were burned alive for refusing to abide by the new catechism. And, you know, you sort of read about these cases and you think, gosh, that's a strange old world. But then you watch these politicians in our era and in Australia, in Britain, and occasionally in America as well, And they're just desperately trying to say the right thing in the new, ridiculous, recently made up catechism, and not, you know, tread on the wrong toes of absolute maniacs. I mean, it's so pathetic. I just feel sorry for any grown-up who's put through these sorts of struggle sessions. If Ed Davey thinks it's actually obvious that women can have penises, I just love to know what the literature is he got that from.
Yes. Now, let's talk about Monty Python's The Life of Brian, one of the most memorable scenes in that, a Nostradamus-like bit of satire, is this.
I want to be a woman. From now on, I want you all to call me Loretta.
What?
It's my right as a man.
Well, why do you want to be Loretta, Stan?
I want to have babies.
You want to have babies?
It's every man's right to have babies if he wants them.
But you can't have babies!
Don't you oppress me.
I'm not oppressing you, Stan. You haven't got a womb. Where's the fetus going to gestate? You're going to keep it in a box?
But now in the upcoming stage revival of Monty Python's Life of Brian, that brilliant scene has been neutered thanks to the usual outrage merchants, Douglas. Can you believe that? That is the scene that should be the selling point.
It's so funny, Rita. I mean, there was an episode of South Park a few years ago where Cartman wants to use the girls' lavatory and so immediately just announces that he's trans. And that was way ahead of its time. It was only about 6 years ago. Monty Python were ahead of their time almost six decades ago. I mean, 50 years ago, certainly, at least. I mean, it's amazing what Monty Python created, what they did. And people of my generation said it. We know the Life of Brian. I mean, I could pretty much do the whole script. It is so memorable, such a comic masterpiece. And it's always strange when an era comes along that thinks it's sort of accepting and all about tolerance and so on, and it can't put up with jokes that have survived as among the most cherished jokes for decades. I think that they can't butcher The Life of Brian, really. It's probably the greatest comic movie ever made. The more they try to suppress this sort of thing, the more people will find out about it. The more they will realize that our age is mad, and that ages before ours seemed relatively sane by comparison.
Well, I still think the majority of the population is sane. It's just all the institutions, all the media and the Hollywood celebrity class who have completely lost their minds. But I think the bulk of the population is holding on for dear life to that sanity. Now, I've got to ask you about this. This is your hometown, New York City, where one wacky far-left academic has menaced a reporter with a machete. As the New York Post reports, the unhinged Manhattan College professor, Shalene Rodriguez, who went viral for abusing anti-abortion students, held a machete to a New York Post reporter's neck this week and made threatening remarks about chopping him up. Now, she has now been relieved of her duties. That's a relief. But why wasn't there any action when she was verbally abusing conservative students who were doing nothing to deserve that abuse? It seems like these academics have got license to behave in a manner that is completely unacceptable.
Yes, I mean, I thought that it was striking that Hunter College had to wait for their employee to put a machete to a journalist's throat to realise that it's quite a bad look, this whole thing. I think there's actually an underlying point that needs to come out here. This woman, Rodriguez, she claimed that conservative students handing out pro-life material was violence, okay? She claimed that their speech was violence. Well, what then is putting a machete to a person's throat? You see, we live in this era where speech is violence, but violence is sort of what we used to call speech or something like that. But all the time in this era, we've had the demeaning of terms we need. Conservative students speaking on campus is not violence, it's speech, free speech. It's the First Amendment protection in America. But if you pretend that a conservative speaking is violence, you run out of terms to describe people like this lunatic and what she did. And she pursued the journalist into the street wielding a machete. I'd say that's violence, not conservatives saying what they think.
Well said, Douglas Murray. I saw some signs this week about white silence is violence. So if you're white and you're silent about something that they want you to be outspoken about, you're violent. I mean, the definitions are forever changing. Thank you so much. I'll speak to you again next week.
Great pleasure as always.